Welcome to r/TalesFromYourServer. It's the place where waiters share awesome stories about their guests. And today's first story is, honestly, we mostly complain because of the pricing. So a year ago, I used to work as a waitress at a Waffle House. I have endless stories of crappy customers, bad manners, harassment, and insane coworker behavior that would never fly in any other sit-down restaurant with servers. However, the crown jewel of SH customers having fits over stupid SH during my experience as a server goes to a particular party of four who regularly came in every Thursday. So let's introduce you to these lovely people. There was a middle-aged couple, the husband's sister and the wife's mother. Let's call the middle-aged wife Karen. Karen had exactly the haircut you'd expect, always badly dyed box blonde and graying at the roots. Wore a constant snooty grimace and often dressed in business formal clothes that had definitely seen their best days back in the 90s. Hubby always looked downtrodden and tired, but was generally polite when he did actually ever talk. He would often wander out for a cigarette and spent most of his time brooding over his coffee, hunched into his leather jacket, as if hoping to avoid the attention of the three women in his company. His sister generally acted too good for everybody and had the same I know better than you attitude as Karen, so I think I'll call her Susan. Last but not least, Karen's mom had to be 100 years old and was as bitter as the dark roast coffee she always drank. She had cataracts that rendered her functionally blind, a shock of thin snow-white hair that she kept incredibly short, and wore a string of pearls and several very old rings that she was always eager to show off to anyone who gave her the chance. They would come by every Thursday and order off the $5 menu. By all accounts, they'd been coming to Waffle House every Thursday for 20 years. All the servers knew them, and for the most part, they never caused any issues. That is until Waffle House corporate started messing with the specials. First, the $5 menu became the $6 menu. Then after 2 months, corporate decided that was still too cheap and made it the $7 menu. Within a month, that was gone too, because corporate just couldn't justify discounting the meals any longer, as it was affecting the profit margin on those menu items. It upset a lot of the older customers we had, since many of them had been coming to Waffle House to get the $5 waffle and bacon special for longer than I care to think about. So these four regulars come in on a lovely busy Thursday rush hour, and I seat them, get them drinks, and inevitably have to notify them we no longer have value menus when they ask for them. Immediately, the whole detached but polite attitudes of Susan and Karen change. I tense for a chew out, but after sharing a brief look, they shrug and all order their normal coffees with large orange juices on the side. Finally, after a million questions and much deliberation, they decide to each order the All-Star Special. Now, the All-Star Special is $9.10, plus a $2 drink and tax. That brought it to $12.12. Well, we were also doing blueberry waffles, which is a 50-cent upcharge. That brings the base meal to $12.62. This doesn't include the extra orange juices they ordered, which were an additional $2. So do the math, a $9.10 meal plus a 50-cent add-on plus two drinks at $2 each. That's $13.60 a meal plus tax. After tax, it's $14.85 per meal, and there were four of them. The meal came to nearly $60 all said and done. I was delighted. Normally, they would spend $21.85 and tip me exactly 15%, which was $3.28. I figured I should at least get a $5 bill. Well, remember how I mentioned it was rush hour? Well, I had 20 other totally full tables in the place, and only one other waitress and one cook. I was waiting 15 to 25 minutes per order, because the grill was chock full of cooking food, and four All-Stars isn't a small order by any means. It took about 30 minutes to get their order cooked, and Karen and Susan both informed me immediately that it was ridiculous that they wait so long for their meals. As per policy, I apologized despite it not being my fault at all. For the rest of their meal, I was attentive as possible, hoping to still get a good tip if I could make up for their wait time. Everything seemed fine, until I was ringing them out. A customer at the bar asked about the earrings I was wearing, and if I was some sort of Satanist devil-worshipping type. They were small silver pentacles, and I politely told the customer while counting Karen's cash out that no, I did not worship the devil, but that I was pagan, and followed my paternal grandmother's Native American beliefs. I explained the earrings were a birthday gift from a well-meaning international friend who didn't know that Native Americans didn't use typical pagan symbols, like pentacles, in their practices. The moment the words were out of my mouth, I saw Karen's face twist in disgust and knew I'd made a mistake answering that question in front of her. She stormed off, and after much whispering and grumbling between Karen and Susan, Susan went out to their car, came back, and set something on the table before they all take their leftovers and bail. When I go to bust my table so I can seat a new family, I discover that instead of tipping me actual money I could put towards rent or food for my own household, they had left a small pamphlet that said, "And God so loved the world," on the front, and was filled with Bible verses on every other available space. I was bitterly disappointed to take a tip loss on such a high check, but shrugged it off and continued my night as normal. Well, lo and behold, nothing was over like I thought it was. The next morning, Karen calls in and demands to speak to the store manager, Chris. Chris wasn't anywhere to be found, so I hand the phone over to our relief manager, Tia. Karen spends over an hour screaming at her before Chris shows up and takes over the call. Another hour later, Chris finally gets off the phone and calls me into the office. She told me Karen had said that I was a terrible waitress. They'd had to wait over an hour for their food, and that I had been too busy talking about how I was some sort of devil-worshipping freak to another customer to take care of them. Tia, who'd initially taken the call, had been my cook the night before, and told Chris that this woman was full of SH. Despite Tia having my back, I still took the fall. Chris had chosen to tell Karen that she and her family could come in next week and have their entire meal replaced for free. This meant for me that the cost of that comp would come out of my wages, and I would be written up. I was also strictly told I wasn't to take their table again next time they came by. So a week later when they come in, I stay as far away as I can, up until time to cash them out. As the 2 p.m. waitress, the drawer was mine and I had to handle all ringouts, even for comp orders. So I ring in the comp, Tia rings in the comp code, and I print the receipt for my drawer's records. While this happens, my cook is talking to the others, making sure their replacement meal was good. Susan tells her, with me and my relief manager in earshot, "Oh well, it wasn't the food or the service that was bad last time. That was fine. Honestly, we mostly complained because of the pricing. We've never had a $60 ticket before." My mouth dropped. Tears started to well in my eyes, and my cook just stared at this woman in disgust. I desperately wanted to say something, but before I could, Tia came to my rescue. "You're telling me that you cost my best second shift server $60 out of her paycheck, got her written up, and screamed at both myself and the store manager for over an hour because you were peeved off about the cost of your meals? If you didn't want to spend $60, you should not have ordered 4 all-star specials." Susan looks at me wide-eyed and shocked, while Karen turns beet red. Susan stuttered something about not knowing it would be taken out of my check and beat a hasty retreat. Karen, however, stood her ground and said, "Well, if she doesn't want her pay cut, then maybe she shouldn't be overcharging some of your best-paying customers. We've been coming here for 20 years. At this point, Tia blew up and said none of her girls would ever be at the mercy of a bitter penny-pinching bee looking for free meals again, and told Karen none of them were allowed back. They left in a huff, but the next day they tried to call and complain to Chris again. Unluckily for them, Tia picked up. The day after this, they come in and start yelling at my relief manager. Tia asked her to leave, and Karen retaliated by picking up another customer's lemonade and throwing it on Tia. Tia called the cops, they were escorted out, and banned from the premises for assaulting my relief manager. This is still legitimately one of the most insane things that ever happened with a customer, although it doesn't touch the staff-related insanity, in the entire time I worked there. The second story is, how a creep got himself fired. Recently read a story that reminded me of this, so I want to share it as a reminder that actions have consequences. This is long, so TLDR at the end. So, some odd years ago, my restaurant department accepted a transfer from another. Let's call him Joe. He was a bit older than me and not at all someone I would consider befriending or hanging with outside of work. I train him, and about maybe 2 weeks in, he makes an offhanded comment in the back station about how much he likes pale white girls with red hair and tattoos, which described me. I brushed it off and we moved on. The next comment came while I was texting my sis, and we sent some pictures of each other. He looks over and tells me to show him some nice pictures of myself, since he wanted to see what I look like out of uniform and work. Yeah, no. He left and my coworker that recently was promoted as supervisor asked me if I wanted him to address that with our manager. I tell him to please do, because Joe is really starting to creep me out. Now, my memory is a bit foggy, but those details were clear. This guy is straight up being weird and inappropriate. A few days later, my manager and I take a walk, and she asks me what's been going on. I let her know and hadn't even thought to bring it to her until my supervisor suggested it. She asks if I'm still comfortable working as we are. I tell her as long as Joe backs off, everything will be fine, and she doesn't need to move around the schedule. She doesn't want to lose me over this, but we still need Joe to help with our department. Understandable. Sometime within the next week from that, Joe and I were alone in the back briefly. I think we were doing some cleaning or restocking. He asks me if he can ask me a personal question. I tell him it really depends on what he wants to ask. This effing scum asks me what my bra size is. Record scratch. Mic drop. Ear canals shatter. I paused to process that, and holy F, I was about to knock his teeth in. Guys, I was peeved. I froze, told him no, he cannot ask that, do not even look at me. The rest of the day honestly is black, I don't remember how it went. Now at that time, our schedule had everyone's phone number on it for easily connecting, and switching shifts and whatnot. That night I got a text from a new number, it said, "Hey, oh no no cat, it's Joe." I never replied, I left it alone, my skin was crawling, I had to do something. The very next morning, I walked in early to my shift and went right to HR, past a manager I knew was in a higher tier than my own. He could tell something was wrong and stopped me to ask what's going on. I told him everything that Joe had done. He was so mad, telling me about his daughter my age and how he'd take that boy out back if it were her and make sure he could never speak again. Cool, dude. I let him know I'm on my way to HR. He wishes me luck and told me to come to him right away next time and winks. HR is not impressed, had me write a statement. I told my supervisor and he came out as well to make his own. My manager's in trouble for allowing it to escalate, and he wants to cover his own back. I show them the text. They want to know how I even got my number. Manager is in trouble more because of the ease of access to our personal info, or something. Meeting in a couple of days to sit with them and my manager. We go over everything. No more schedule listing out numbers. They ask me if they can put him back with his original department. I tell them as long as I don't have to work with him anymore. They call him up. I go back to work. He never came back. They fired him. Guess he didn't deny anything, and said he was trying to get a hold of me to apologize. Ha ha ha, I don't think so. Not 30 minutes past midnight he wasn't. And the third story is, y'all, I won the lotto tonight. Hey everybody, just some quick background. I work in a sports arena as an order taker. Basically, I'm a waiter or hot dog man 2.0, if you will. I have seats instead of tables, but other than that, it's pretty much the same thing. Tonight I have my hockey section, which means I have wheelchair. It's about half the size of a normal section, only having 50 seats or so. This means for the most part, I don't make as much money. The money isn't awful, but it's usually $75 to $90-ish for 4 hours, and my normal size basketball section makes up for it. Tonight though, I had this large group come in. I greet them, say welcome to arena, give them my name and tell them I'm basically their waiter, and listing my actual job title just confuses people. They ask if they can run a tab. No problem, I just need a credit card to open the tab, and something to get in an order. So they order a round of drinks for everyone, mostly consisting of double shot liquor and mixers and a few food items. Already their tab is at $165+, which is often about as high as my big tabs go sometimes, but then they just keep ordering, and ordering, and ordering. By the end of the night, their tab is more than $800. Keep in mind I was also servicing the rest of the 50-seat section, which is like 75% full. I come when they're ready to close out, and they say they want to pay in cash instead of card. They hand me $1,000 and ask, are we good? Yup. No, really, are we good? No, really, yup. It's really important to us that we take care of people, are you sure we're good? Sir, if I were a little less straight, I'd be giving you a kiss. You're super duper good. Okay, you've been really great tonight. Thank you so much. The best part? In a section where I'm usually doing well to make 600 in sales, between the rainmakers and the rest of my section, my sales were so high my supervisors in the kitchen were convinced that it was computer error. They asked me if I really had the $700+ I owed the house. I wish I could have seen the look on my face, as I whipped out my load and started counting it on the counter. After tipping out the runners that had been running food and drink to that party all night, and the service bartender that made all the drinks, I still went home with more than $250 in my wallet. Pretty D good for a 4-hour Monday shift. Thank you for watching. Bye!